Hi, John here, game dev, 26 years old. Yeah, I still have to learn how to start videos, so let's just skip the intro and get to it. I've been watching some video devlogs lately. The first uploads are usually cheering, getting the character controller working, running around in the world. But the more the project grows, the more problems arise. One particular YouTuber, Robert Thomson, had seemingly no issues making smaller games, but then such a bad time with its big project. Watching his video kinda broke my heart, so I decided to go over the main points to consider when developing a big game. First things first, the hardware. You need a good PC to make a big game. It's kinda obvious, but I'll explain why. When a game is built, it is optimized. There are tons of systems running in the background to provide maximum performance. In the editor, most of those systems aren't running. If your PC would be good enough to barely run the game at 60 FPS, it is way too weak to run smoothly in the editor and you will have a very bad time just navigating your game world. The next thing is lighting. If you have a landscape with towns and caves and tons of meshes, baking the lighting is just impossible. Don't even try. That's because baked lighting generates textures. So all your meshes, all surfaces, all triangles in your game are UV unwrapped side by side onto multiple textures. Then for each light, rays are emitted, bounce off other surfaces and write to those textures. In a big game, those textures don't fit on your memory and baking would take forever. Imagine moving a stone a few centimeters and then baking for 48 hours. Even when the memory problem would magically disappear, this would still break your entire workflow. Also, those textures would add many gigabytes to your build size. ProBuild is a cool tool for prototyping and getting some meshes into your scene quickly. For small scenes, it is feasible to keep those meshes and just add textures to it. But looking at the code of ProBuilder, it is pretty obvious why you shouldn't use those generated meshes in a large scene. They regenerate all the time, on undo, redo, when you close and open the editor, sometimes when entering the play mode, when loading, unloading scenes. This means they throw away the mesh they have and recreate all vertices, triangles, normals, and UVs. If you have a few hundred of those objects, everything will be painfully slow. The same applies for text mesh, line renderer, or assets and tools that generate meshes. You want to avoid this at all costs. So export ProBuilder meshes and make them into assets so they act like any other mesh, or avoid it altogether and use modular meshes instead, but more on that later. The basic concept when working on big games is that you actually have to care about editor performance. You have to handle that on your own. And the basics are pretty much the same for in-game and editor performance. Don't display everything at once. The best approach for collaboration with others, as well as keeping things sorted, clean, and structured, is using multiple scenes. This comes with a major downside. You can't reference anything from one scene in another scene. But that's also a good thing because you don't want these dependencies. So avoid them whenever you can. And when you can't, use the cross-scene reference Unity built for the big shooter game they made. Also, when you feel like it's getting slower, profile. Yes, you can profile in the editor and it will tell you exactly what makes things slow. Avoid initialize on load and initialize on load method attributes as much as you can. They fire on every recompile and all their code will execute whenever you save a script. Avoid find asset of type and all methods of those kinds. In a big game, you never want to search through your entire asset database. And when you have to, make a button with a warning. The same applies for code that searches through all open scenes. Now we know how to handle performance in the editor. But what about performance at runtime? One of the core concepts is to see your game from the perspective of your player character. Think about the giant world filled with quests, with NPCs, enemies, items, towns, caves, dungeons, everything. That's a huge amount of data you want to fit into a small amount of memory. That's a huge amount of vertices and textures you want to push on the tiny GPU memory. And a huge amount of scripts that should all run on a CPU with limited computation power. And you want all of that at 60 frames per second. Now, if you don't look at the map as a whole, but from the point of a player, what is actually relevant to him? A player won't care about NPCs fighting at the other side of the map. He won't care about conversations in the town hall of another city. If you zoom in and view it from his eyes, you can create any scene with ease, and it will run at more than 100 frames per second. The city has 1,000 citizens, but on screen are just a few of them. The buildings in the distance usually have millions of triangles, but from here they are just simple boxes. There might be one conversation he can hear, and maybe three NPCs fighting each other just around the corner. But everything else doesn't need to exist right now. Creating a scene that runs at 60 FPS with only the elements that are around the player right now would be very easy. This is a huge open world game, but the number of game objects that are currently loaded is the same as in a small level of a linear game. Making a game that consists just of this area and nothing else would be quite easy. See what I mean? So all we have to do is to break everything up into small chunks and keep the active content at the size of a small level. Okay, let's take a step back and look at the problems with in-game performance in detail. Usually, people will tell you to just make the game and think of performance when you run into problems. And yes, that's a good approach for small games, but for huge games, you want to think about performance right after your prototype phase. Embed it into your design. Make your life easier wherever you can. If you have a city, consider surrounding it with walls, so you don't have to render it from a distance. Add mountains like walls to your level. Use hills and vertical offsets so you can hide things. Or if you have a more linear game, add floodgate doors to hide it when you are loading content. Or at least know that you will need a bunch of LODs for everything. Forget automatic systems. Occlusion culling will take so much CPU time when rotating the camera, it just doesn't improve the performance at all. Forget static batching. If you are handling which content is rendered by yourself, then this will just break your systems. Also, it slows the editor down as it runs whenever you press play. LOD also won't fix all problems for you. It's good to use it, but you can only switch meshes. At some point you want to switch an entire area, like the city example I mentioned before. Unity LOD cannot do that for you. Maybe there is an asset that perfectly fits your needs. If so, maybe, that's a shortcut you can take. The team that made Firewatch has a GDC talk about how they used Sector, and how well it worked for them. I, personally, would always yield my own solution and adjust it specifically for the game I'm making. All of this was mostly about GPU performance, as in not rendering too much at once. But the CPU side is equally important. I won't touch on things that relate to small games. But in huge games, you will have a lot of everything. Each city is populated with NPCs, stores, triggers, item pickups. If you have 10,000 item pickups in your map and you iterate each frame through all of them to check if the player should add it to its inventory, well, that sounds pretty bad for your performance. The same applies for all kinds of systems. Depending on the game world and the type of content loading, you can just iterate over the item pickups in the loaded areas. Otherwise, you can always use a grid or awk tree to avoid searching through every item in the map. Next is physics. There is a limited number of active rigid bodies you can have in your game, so you have to deactivate those whenever you can. These spawn fractures if you have a game where your player can destroy barrels. Basically remove physics wherever the player can't see them. Again, this depends on how your content loading works. Note that non-moving colliders also add to the calculation. Try to use primitive colliders where it's possible and deactivate colliders you don't need. A special case I had to solve with my system was when the player was dragging a physical object between sectors. The object is part of a sector that gets deactivated. Now when the player leaves the sector, I don't want the object to disappear in his hands. And when he drops it, it shouldn't disappear either. You have to solve such edge cases in your content loading system. I solved it with onCollision Enter. When the player picks an object, it is part of the null sector, so it won't unload at all. And when he drops the object, it gets the sector it collides with. And when something bad happens and it falls through the map, it will just reset at its initial position. NPCs are a complicated topic on their own, especially in huge games. If your game is like Portal and you go from level to level, it might be okay to have all enemies in the scene active all the time. Well, in a big game, this isn't the case. A common technique is spawning people and vehicles around corners or behind the player, and despawning them at a certain distance. Of course, this means that your cities have an infinite population, but walking in a real city usually feels the same. As said, this is a complicated topic, so I won't go into the details here. But basically, non-player characters don't have to decide what to do on every single frame. You can queue them up and only calculate 5 NPCs per frame, for example. For the navigation, if you are using NavMesh, you also want to split this up into regions. To do that, use the NavMesh components from Unity and forget the built-in navigation tab. So now you can forget about the static checkbox entirely, as you are not using any of these optimizations. With the NavMesh component, you can create a NavMesh surface, which is a component on a game object in your scene. You can then set the Collect Objects field to Volume, and you will have your regional NavMesh ready to go. So when you make changes to one part of your game, you don't have to load everything in the editor and bake the NavMesh for the whole game world again. The code is open source, so you can alter the NavMesh surface so it ignores trigger colliders, for example. To connect NavMesh surfaces, you can use NavMesh links. Memory management is also an important topic in huge games, but I haven't touched this area since our game, Obey the Architects, is reusing the assets over and over, which means that we don't have to unload anything. I mean, we could probably unload the scenes, but all of them are just using about 500 MB uncompressed in the editor. Probably less in the build. All I can say is that there is a package for memory management provided by Unity. It's called Addressables. And there are some good tutorials out there on how to use them. Also, there's the memory profiler so you can see what is filling up your memory. You should always reuse as many assets as you can. With instanced rendering, this saves a lot of performance. You won't have to deal with a lot of data, memory-wise. Your asset database will grow slower, which is also beneficial to the editor performance. The build size decreases, which leads to faster download times and more disk space for your end users and playtesters. And you won't have to create new meshes all the time. Tons of benefits, as you can see. Also have a look at the material property override. It lets you alter specific material fields per object without creating a new material asset. By the way, this doesn't break GPU instancing. Coding a big game. Well, this is probably stuff for a whole other 2 or 3 videos. To keep it short, you want encapsulated systems and you want some kind of unified communication system for all of them. Probably something like an event system. Write a comment if you want a more detailed explanation on writing code for a complex game. And again, like in the editor, profiling is key. Whenever you notice frame drops, open the profiler and check what's causing those. Profiling will not work when you are GPU bound. As far as I know, there is no tool that tells you what meshes or shaders are killing your performance. So the only way to detect it is to manually turn off game objects while the game is running, watching the frame rate while doing so. The good thing is, to 99% it will be the terrain or particle systems. The Unity terrain is, well, I don't really like it. It was causing massive performance problems in the past, which all had to do with details rendering, like trees or rocks or grass. I prefer to place prefabs with LODs instead and avoid that feature entirely. This provides more artistic freedom and prevents performance problems. The last part on my list is staying on the safe side. As said, I was inspired to make this video because of the Devlog by Robert Thomson. He tried to make a shader to place windows in his buildings and it didn't work out. So generally speaking, I would say keep things simple. Complex solutions might work now, but can make more problems down the road. This was quite a long list, so let's summarize this. Have the right hardware. Use real-time lighting only, as baked lighting won't work. Avoid ProBuilder and other mesh-generating components in your scenes. Take care of the editor performance. Split your game into chunks you can easily display. Profile the editor. See the world from the perspective of your player. Plan your world with performance in mind. Forget automatic systems like occlusion culling or static batching. Use areas or a grid to find nearby objects. Limit the number of active rigid bodies. Only calculate relevant NPCs, spread calculations over multiple frames. Spawn and despawn NPCs around the player. Use NavMesh components to create regional NavMeshes. Use addressables for memory management. Reuse your assets. Write encapsulated code. Use a unified communication system. Profile often. Deactivate objects for pseudo GPU profiling. Keep things simple. Tell me if you liked the video by using the like button below. Subscribe if you want more content like this. If you have any questions or suggestions for future videos, write me a comment. Thanks so much for watching and stay motivated, fellow indies. And a big shout out to my top 10 Patreons. NPC. NPC1, empty game object, material, particle system, new mono behavior, NPC2, default cube, null reference exception, object reference not set to an instance of an object, missing prefab with GUID 930BCFDC617B477469F22481B833B5B2.